NICEF, the National Institute for Nuclear and Elementary Particle Physics, is a joint venture of the institution Fundamental Research of Matter in the Netherlands and four universities, two Amsterdam universities, University of Nijmegen and the University of Utrecht. What is the scientific mission of NICEF? We want to do research by scattering electrons from clusterizations of nucleons, protons, neutrons, and mesons into atomic nuclei. We do that by exciting these systems and looking to their behavior, to their decay, the way the absorption of energy is transmitted into those systems. It is a mixture of nuclear and elementary particle physics. What we in particular want to study is correlation phenomena in these condensed clusters of nucleons. We want to excite them and see how they propagate and decay in nuclear matter. And essentially, you want to understand what the role of quarks and gluons is in those systems of nucleons. It's very important to know that because at the birth of the universe, about 15 billion years ago, these clusterizations took place, and we have them now around us, and we can understand what's going on by scattering electrons from those systems. In the previous round of experiments with the linear accelerator MEA, we have done some very interesting observations but could only see glimpses of what's going on. And to better see and understand what's going on in these systems, we need new and advanced technology, accelerators and detectors. And that is AMPS, the Amsterdam Pulse Stretcher.
Here you see the scattering chamber that we actually use in our experiments. An example of experiments we did in the past is the measurement of the momentum or velocity of protons inside the atomic nucleus. What we did is we used the electron beam of MEA to knock out one of the protons out of the nuclei, and we used these two detectors to detect both the proton and the electron. The results of one of those measurements on carbon-12 you see in this figure. You see that the distribution peaks at a velocity of about 30,000 kilometers per second, which corresponds to about 100 MeV over c in momentum. A striking aspect of this figure is that we didn't have data beyond, say, 70,000 kilometers per second because of the low duty factor of our previous machine. Nowadays, it will be possible to perform measurements at these high velocities and high momenta. To the common public, we explain the need for this high duty factor machine, AMPS, using the following example. Imagine you have a dark room with boys and girls, and we would like to discriminate between the boys and girls. The analogy with the previous situation is that we have a flashlight which turns on and off now and then, and you see that it is very hard to discriminate between the boys and girls. Nowadays, the analogy is a low intensity light which has the same net effect in time, and then it is very easy to see who are the boys and who are the girls. Except for the measurement of the high momenta components in nuclei, we also do other research with AMPS. Two examples. One example is the excitation of delta resonance, the first excited state of a proton, inside atomic nuclei. It decays into a pion and a proton, both of which we want to detect, of course. The second example is a search for the equivalent of six quark bags inside nuclei. For both studies, we need, except for the two detectors you see over here, a third proton detector, a prototype of which we will see right now. Here you see two prototypes of the additional detectors we need for our experiments. These prototypes have been developed in collaboration with the Free University here in Amsterdam. Except for these two prototypes, we also have two larger detectors of this type available for our experiments. Except for the experiments we are doing with these type of detectors, we are also developing a completely new kind of experiments, the so-called internal target experiments. In these experiments, the electrons are interacting with the gas of target atoms. The importance of these experiments is that it will be possible to do experiments with polarized targets and to do so-called recoil detection experiments. A prototype of the gas jet is seen over here. You see a tiny light blue signal reflecting the interaction of the gas with the beam electrons. It is clear that a large technical effort is needed to support our scientific goals.
Let me first explain the principle of our Amsterdam pulse stretcher. When we started some 10 years ago, we only had a linear accelerator. That linear accelerator was providing pulses of electrons that were guided towards an electron scattering target. Soon it appeared that the pulses were not that efficient because of coincidence experiments. Therefore, we decided to make a continuous beam of electrons. We kept our accelerator, our LINAC, but we added a storage ring, and we guided our electrons into that storage ring. The storage ring is filled with one pulse of electrons, and these accumulated electrons in the storage ring are then extracted slowly and guided towards the target. The principle of the accelerator is probably well known to most of you. We do have an electron gun at 400 kilovolts, and after these 400 kilovolts we accelerate with RF fields. We have a traveling wave accelerator, and we accelerate at 3 gigahertz. In total, we use 13 modulators to provide the accelerating field. The total power of these modulators is 1.3 megawatt. In each pulse of the electron accelerator, we provide 10 to the 12th electrons, and we achieve a maximum energy of 1 giga electron volts. I suggest that we now go downstairs and have a look at the beam switch chart and at the ring itself. This is the beam switch chart. It consists of a lot of heavy dipoles with very strong fields of 1.5 Tesla. With these magnets, we direct the electron beam from the LINAC towards the target or to the ring. This over here is the ring. It consists of a stainless steel vacuum pipe, circumference of 212 meters, pumped down with ion getter pumps. We use electromagnetic lenses, the quadrupole type, to keep the beam together within a few millimeters. Some sexypole magnets with special chromaticity control. And of course, the beam is kept in the ring with dipole magnets. In total, we have 164 magnetic elements. These electromagnetic elements are kept in a very reproducible position on these strongbacks. The magnets have been aligned within 0.1 of a millimeter with laser equipment. Beam position is controlled with these strip line monitors, and the extraction is achieved with thin electrostatic septum. All these items have been manufactured within NICAF, within the NICAF workshops and with the NICAF manpower. Nevertheless, we had to go outside to buy a lot of the large quantity elements. You can buy these items in shops, so you first have to produce a prototype before you start shopping. Quite a lot of the elements have been manufactured within the Netherlands, for example, these high accurately manufactured magnets. This type of large projects can only be achieved when you have a very close and good relationship and collaboration between physicists and engineers.
The challenging research program of NICAF can only be carried out thanks to an intensive collaboration of technicians and physicists. This has led to a unique facility, the AMS facility. It's unique in the Netherlands and in Europe. And this is, for instance, shown by the series of letters that we have received from scientists from abroad who have expressed their wish to collaborate with us in the AMS program. In addition to knowledge, there's also the aspect of training in the Institute. We train technicians in a high technology environment, and we also train young scientists to become trained scientists. This is of vital interest for the Dutch society because they need trained technicians and scientists. And thanks to AMS, we can do challenging research until the end of the century.